Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the Lord's house this morning as we worship on Palm Sunday. And our theme for worship is rethinking religion. What does a king do? All right, so we're going to take a look at our triumphant king marching into Jerusalem on a donkey and how that affects us and in our Christian life. We'll follow the order service of setting number one, and we'll begin our worship with our opening hymn. During the opening hymn, if you have a palm branch, I want you to raise it up as you sing, and then during verses 2 through 5, if you are able, I would invite you to bring them forward, and we'll just lay our palm branches down here. There's no processional of any kind. You just simply, if you're able, bring it up here and place it down and return to your seat for worship. God's blessings on our worship today, and let's join in singing hymn 412, All Glory, Laud, and Honor.
Of children made sweet hosannas ring. The people of the Hebrews with palms before you went. Our praise and prayer and anthems before you present. All glory, Lord, and honor to you, Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children made sweet hosannas ring. To you before your passion they sing their hymns of praise. To you now high exalted, our melody we raise.
Please stand.
All glory, Lord, and honor to you, Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children made sweet hosannas ring. As you receive their praises, accept the prayers we bring. O source of every blessing, our good and gracious King. lips of children made sweet hosannas ring.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Amen. Blessed are they whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed are they whose sin the Lord does not count against them. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Almighty and merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed what we have devised and desired in our hearts. We have offended you and sinned against your holy law. We have done those things that we should not have done, and we have not done those things that we should have done. Have mercy on us, Lord. Spare us, forgive us, and restore us according to your promises in Christ Jesus. God, our merciful Father, has forgiven all our sins. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and Savior. Jesus paid the penalty for our guilt by his resurrection from the grave. We have peace with God now and forever. Amen. Let us join in singing, Lord, Have Mercy, verses 1 and 2.
Have done and left undone, we fall on your countless mercies. For sins that are known and those unknown, we call on your name so holy. For envy and pride, for closing our eyes, for scorning our very neighbor. In thought, word, and deed, we failed you, our King. How deeply we need a Savior. Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. For what you have done, your life of love, you perfectly lived, we praise you. Though tempted and tried, you fix your eyes, you finish the work God gave you. And there on the tree, a king among thieves, glad for our world's betrayal. You love to the end, our merciful friend, how pure and forever faithful. Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. on us.
The Lord be with you. We pray. We praise you, O God, for the great acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ, as he was acclaimed by those who scattered their garments and branches of palms in his path. So may we always hail him as our King and follow him with perfect confidence, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Our first lesson today, appointed for Palm Sunday, is from Zechariah chapter 9. Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and brings salvation. He is humble and is riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem. The battle bow will be taken away, and he will proclaim peace to the nations. His kingdom will extend from sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will release your prisoners from the waterless pit. Return to the stronghold, you prisoners who have hope. This very day I declare that I will restore double to you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's now join in singing with the choir. Psalm 24D will follow the instructions that are on the screen. Our second lesson from Hebrews chapter 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us get rid of every burden and sin that so easily ensnares us, and let us run with patient endurance the race that is laid out for us. Let us keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, who is the author of our faith and the one who brings it to its goal. In view of the joy set before him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of God's throne. Carefully consider him who endured such hostility against himself from sinful people, so that you do not grow weary and lose heart. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as the choir sings the gospel acclamation. The Gospel, Lord, according to Mark chapter 11. This portion of the word will serve as the basis of the sermon today. As they approached Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and told them, "Go into the village ahead of you. As soon as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and he will send it back here without delay.' They left and found the colt on the street, tied at a door, and they untied it. Some who were standing there asked them, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' The disciples answered them just as Jesus had instructed them, and the men let them go. They brought the colt to Jesus, threw their garments on it, and Jesus sat on it. Many people spread their garments on the road, others spread branches that they had cut from the fields. Those who went in front and those who followed were crying out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
You may be seated as we join in singing our hymn of the day, hymn 411, "Ride On, Ride On in Majesty."
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God for our consideration today is taken from the gospel lesson from Mark chapter 11, my dear brother and sister in the Lord. As we take a look at our lesson for today, we will notice a very sharp contrast with what's about to come. It's a sharp contrast because the same voices that echo out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," will soon be now saying in a few days, "Crucify him." This entire contrast is something that we have been able to see throughout the ministry of Jesus. In fact, when Jesus first came into the world, you can see how he really did not do things like a king normally would. The way in which he came into the world when he was born was not like an ordinary king. He was not born in a palace. He was not wrapped in delightfully soft cloths. He was not in a room. He was not even by a fireplace. He was not anywhere where any comfort or glitz or glamour could be. In fact, the first people that saw Jesus, they were not delegates from a foreign nation who were coming to make sure that they were right and good and friends of this newborn king. But instead, they were shepherds. And then later on in his life, when people saw Jesus feed thousands of people with bread and fish, they all thought to themselves, "Boy, this might be nice. Let's make him our king." And Jesus actually withdrew from them. As Jesus is entering Jerusalem today, you see this sharp contrast because now, instead of refusing the praises of the people, he accepts them because he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, coming to do his Father's will, coming to save mankind from their sin, coming to defeat the devil, and coming to once and for all destroy the power of death. And so Jesus rides on into Jerusalem today to the shouts and acclamations of the people. But he's doing it not like other kings would, because Jesus himself is not just another king. He is greater than all. And yet, he is gentle and he is meek. As the Lord Jesus rides into Jerusalem, our lesson gives us the full picture of all that is taking place. Jesus, in fact, directs his disciples to go into a town and find somebody else's colt, untie it, and when they ask him, "What are you doing?" this is what you are to say. You can see Jesus on Sunday, prior to him being put to death, in absolute and total control. He knows exactly what's going to happen. He knows exactly how it will be. And he directs his disciples to follow his commands and do exactly as he says. And so the disciples go into town and they find the donkey right where it's supposed to be. And then people who ask him, "What are you doing?" they said exactly what the Lord said, and they were on their way. They brought the donkey to Jesus. And Jesus sat on this colt, the foal of a donkey, never been ridden before, and he majestically rides into town on a donkey. He's not just another king, because would this be how you would do it if you were a king? Probably not. In fact, in all of the movies that we have ever seen depicting the kings and good kings of this world, this isn't how it goes, right? Many of you, I'm sure, have seen Aladdin, either the classic or probably the less than classic one that just came out recently. But you remember, right? When Prince Ali came onto the scene, it was not just a small thing. It was a big theatrical thing. He rode in on this majestic animal, right? And he was doing everything that you and I would depict as kingly. Jesus? On a donkey. He has no armies around him, right? He is not giving a sign of force or showing all of his might. He doesn't even have his chest puffed out as he is going in on this large mantle. But instead, he is not just another king. He's not coming to show his force over the powers of this world, but he is coming once and for all to do away with the powers that would prevent any of us from entering his heavenly kingdom. As Jesus rides into Jerusalem, the words that he hears are a fulfillment of the very words that we saw in Zechariah. Hosanna. The word in and of itself means Lord, save us. And how ironic that they were thinking they were going to be saved from Roman oppression. But instead, the Lord who came to save, who's not just another king, came to overcome sin, death, and the devil for you and for me. He came because he saw in you and me the very sins that separate us from God. We know Jesus is not just another king because, frankly, in our lives, there is one king, isn't there? It's you. It's me. When we look in the mirror, we struggle the most with how we are number one in our lives. We oftentimes shake our fists at God in anger because, as our king, that's not what I would have done. That's not how I would have done it, Lord. Lord, what are you doing? We cry out. You see, when we act as the one who is in charge, when we act as the one who thinks he knows everything, as we act as the one who thinks we have the power to affect everything in this world, we realize that we're mere mortals. We realize that we're mere sinful people. We realize that we really stink at this. And we realize that we need a desperate handout from our Lord. Because the last time we took charge, the last time we thought, I'm going to do this all on my own, the last time we thought, I don't need anybody else's help, how'd that go? Was it just like me, where you felt like you were burnt out, flat on your face, not realizing how difficult the things of this world is? Was it possibly the reality of all the things of this world that are completely outside of your control? No matter what you do, no matter how you do it, you simply cannot affect change. Difficult. So we need a king. We need a king who actually is greater than all. We need someone who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And what do you know? Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, sent to mankind, was to do just that. And he came to pay for the very sins that you and I struggle with most. And that sin is ours of thinking that we're number one. Why do you think God tells us, you shall have no other gods before me? It's because you and I, as we stare in the mirror, are staring at the one God that we always put before God. And we need to repent. We need to repent because we have a king. We have a God. And it's not us. But it's Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so Jesus came willingly. He came majestically. He came with power into Jerusalem, knowing fully, as we just sang, that he was riding to his ultimate earthly end. He knew that he was going to suffer. He knew that he was going to be in the hands of sinners. He knew he was going to be beaten. He knew he was going to have this trial that was going to go off the rails. He knew all of this. And yet, he willingly came because he's not just like any other king. He is the king. You see, where you and I look at things and say, I don't know, that seems a little sketchy. I don't think I want to go through that. I don't think I want to deal with that. I don't think if this is what's going to happen, I'll go this way. Jesus knew full well what was at the end of the road. And he marched in and he did not turn. He did not say, I need some other way. But instead, he knew full well that as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, this is exactly why his Father sent him into this world, so that he could save us. And so he went. to the shouts and acclamations of the people, "Hosanna, Lord, save us." And he says, "Yep, it's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm not going to save you from the Romans. You're on your own there. But I'm going to save you from sin, death, and the devil by what I'm going to do for you." And you see him doing this, and he does it in a meek and gentle way. When you think about words to describe a king, my guess is that gentleness, meekness, or humility are not words that you would rightly use to describe kings. Oftentimes, I would say that you would probably say kings are those who are stern, those who are just, those who are powerful and wield their power for themselves and maybe for their people. Not Jesus. Jesus, every step of the way, each and every plop of that donkey's feet, was one of meekness and gentleness and humility. As you heard on Thursday this last week, our Lord Jesus is one who can exercise perfect restraint, which is amazing too, because as you and I struggle so mightily as putting ourselves as number one, meekness, gentleness, and humility are things that we likely struggle with most. You and I are oftentimes probably not described as gentle because in our sinfulness, we do rash things. We do hurtful things. We do mean things. You see, we need a Savior from all of these things, and that's what Jesus did. Our Savior shows us how he is not just another king because he puts on display what he wants, and he wants you. And so as he marches into Jerusalem, he's not going to establish there a kingdom that you and I will be able to visit as he reigns forever, but he is going there because he has established a kingdom in your heart. In fact, you and I pray, and we will in just a moment, "Your kingdom come," in the Lord's Prayer. When we pray that, we are praying that the Lord establish his rule in our hearts. And by establishing a rule in our hearts, that means we change. We then want to share God's word. We want to follow God's word. We want to do what God has done. And all of a sudden, being meek and gentle and loving because Christ did it is why we do it. See, that's why Christ has come. This is exactly why he is marching into Jerusalem. Because at the end of this road is where the payment for our sins will take place. Jesus Christ our Lord was given glory, laud, and honor, as we have just sung. But their confusion was that they were hoping Jesus would give them more bread, feed them more food, organize an army, and defeat the Romans. That's where their shouts of praise came from. That's what an ordinary king would do. That's what an earthly king would do. Earthly kings want to spread their kingdom in this world and reach these great acclamations in this life. Not Jesus. Jesus instead establishes his kingdom in you and then enables you to go about in spreading his word as if you are now taking marching orders from the King of Glory himself. And now you, equipped with the word, can go to the ends of this world sharing the message of Jesus. Maybe not even to the ends of the world. How about just next door? How about we just knock on our neighbor's door and we share with them how Jesus Christ has rescued us from our sins and has done what we could not have done? How about we invite them to Easter? How about we actually share with people what they need? Because what they need is not what an earthly king would do. What they need is what our King of Glory has done for them. And so as we brought palm branches to the front this morning, and as we sing these hymns of praise to our glorious King, we realize he is not coming for earthly fame and glory, but he is coming to establish his kingdom in you so that you can continue to spread his kingdom throughout the world, so that he could once and for all defeat everything that would prevent you or I from going to his heavenly kingdom for all eternity. Christ has come for you and for me, and he has come to die and to rise again on Easter Sunday so that your sins and mine would forevermore be paid for, and that through faith in him, we would be with him reigning forever in heaven with our King, who's not just any king. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords. He is greater than all, for he is the firstborn from the dead, and he is our gentle and meek Savior. Amen. Please stand. And now may the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard and keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus our Savior. Amen. In place of our confession today, we will have our choir as well as our Jesus Jammers from our school sing the antiphonal Hosanna. The congregation may be seated. Printed responsibly on the screen. And then in our special prayers today, we pray for the Brunk family. Mel Brunk passed away this last week. We pray for Mr. Breitkreutz as well as Mrs. Grauman, who are both considering calls and deliberating between their calls here and elsewhere. We pray for the Easter outreach efforts as we approach Holy Week. We pray for Don Wartgo, who is ill, Don Kraus for an upcoming surgery, Karen Feldkirchner, who is recovering, as well as Carol Brokel, who is recovering. We go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God and Father, we thank you for all your mercies, especially for the gift of your Son, through whom you have revealed your gracious will. We praise you for the Holy Spirit and his working through the means of grace. Plant your word in our hearts and cause it to produce fruit in our lives. Strengthen and defend your church, that by your word and sacraments, faith may grow and love toward all may increase. Support all who spread the light of your truth throughout the world. Keep our children in the grace of their baptisms. Enable their parents to train them in their lives of faith. Raise up Christians to serve you in the ministry of the word and in all godly walks of life. Preserve our nation in justice and honor. Guide and bless all who make, administer, and judge our laws. Give them wisdom that they may promote justice and hinder evil. Let your blessing rest on planting and harvest, commerce and industry, medicine and science, and the arts and culture. Protect all who travel and care for those whose work is difficult or dangerous.
Be with all who devote themselves to any useful task.
Comfort all who are in sorrow or in need, sickness or adversity, especially the Brunk family who are mourning the passing of Mel, and also Don Wartko, who is undergoing physical pain and illness, Karen Feldkirchner, who is recovering from her fall, Carol Brokel, who is recovering from illness, and we ask that you would watch over with loving arms Don Kraus as he goes in for surgery. Remember those who suffer persecution for the faith, and have mercy on those for whom death draws near. Grant them your love, and take them into your tender care. Dear Heavenly Father, your divine call goes out to both Mrs. Grauman and Mr. Breitkreutz as they consider now service here at St. Paul's and elsewhere. We ask that you would grant them peace in the decision that they come to as they see where you have blessed them and where they can use the gifts that you have given them in service to you. Also, Lord God, with the resurrection coming this upcoming Sunday, we ask that you would bless us in our outreach efforts as we reach out to those who do not yet know you. Grant them peace and grant them success as we go from this place, inviting those to come to church and hear the message of your resurrection. We ask this in Jesus' name. And now hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence. We remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you, who now rest from their labors. Console those who are mourning or living with sadness. Keep us in the true faith and bring us at last to the joys of heaven. Grant us these things, Father, for the sake of Jesus who died and rose again. Amen. We'll now gather the offering. And as the offering is being collected, I would invite each of you to sign the friendship register, which is on each of your pews. Thank you. Lord Jesus Christ, with these gifts we bring, a first fruits of our offerings, we ask that you would bless them and use them as we continue to spread your holy word throughout our city and throughout this state and throughout this country. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We now join in singing our next hymn, which is hymn 414, No Tramp of Soldiers' Marching Feet. Stand for prayer. Blessed Lord, you have given us your holy scriptures for our learning. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your holy word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. You may be seated for our closing hymn. Good morning again. Welcome to God's house as we celebrate Palm Sunday today. A couple of announcements. First of all, if of any age, you are invited to Bible study. We have Bible study for the little ones, babies, in the lower section of our daycare in the what they call the gymnasium area. We also have Bible study or Sunday school for our young children. That's in the base of the slide room. We have Sunday school or Bible study for our middle school grades, which is up in the choir room, and also for our high schoolers, which is down in our youth center. And then, of course, we can't forget all of you coffee-drinking adults. We have that Bible study over here in our fellowship hall. So please join us for Bible study today as we study the Word of God. Also today, as you are leaving, you will be handed an invitation for our Easter celebration. What we want you to do with this is take it and give it to someone else. We already know when Easter is here, and I hope to see you all here, and I'm sure I will. But there are those who do not know Jesus. There are those who have no idea what Easter is about, and they are overcome by their sin and sorrow. So invite them so that they find relief in our resurrected Lord. Those invitations will be handed out as you are leaving today, and please share that invitation with one of your friends, family members, or coworkers. That would be great. Other than that, the Lord's blessings to you all. Please keep an eye on the schedule for the Holy Week. There is no 3:30 service on Thursday. We will join together as the body of Christ for communion and Monday-Thursday worship at 6:30 on Monday-Thursday. And so we will see each other then. God's blessings to you all.